So, like I said, this is from a website called Artifacts, which was put together by, I think, the main person involved there was Professor Roger Fisher, who is I think he's retired now, but he's been a professor at the University of Pretoria for a long time. So he's got this website where he tries to put all things South African and architectural onto it. So this was an article that was published in 1994 in our Architecture Essay journal. Do you guys know this journal, Architecture Essay or ASA Architecture? No?
No.
Well, you should know it, and we'll look at some of it quite closely. It's the architectural journal of the South African Institute of Architects, which comes out every second month, and it's like 100 years old, and it's the main journal that we have in the country. It's where all the architectural projects get published, and we have it in our library, and we also it's also been online for some years now. So I can send you the link, and all the journals are online as PDFs, which you can download. So that this is a journal you should know because it is ostensibly the voice of the architectural profession, right? It is where people write articles generally, okay, and where all the work gets published. So if you want to know what is the mainstream of architecture, what are the things that we're talking about, what kind of buildings are being produced, that is where you will find that. Now, this was an article published in, like I said, in 1994. So 1994 is obviously it's not accidental that an article like this appears in 1994. Okay, so during and you're going to see throughout this course, we're going to be shifting back between, we already saw in the first semester how enmeshed apartheid and colonialism were in architectural thinking, how ideas manifested in architectural form, what were the kind of ways in that society was viewed, and what was the ideas of civilization, which sounds so archaic to us now, and domesticating troublesome people, and from the way the cities formed, from the way townships are formed, from the way even the house, even where your kitchen sink is, right? All there was ideas behind all of those things. So we could see already from the first semester that architecture is completely enmeshed in broader social forces, the politics of the day, right? But during the apartheid years, although it was so enmeshed in politics, what was amazing about it is that no one ever spoke about politics. This was what is so extraordinary, is that you could go through year after year of the, and I've studied our journals over the years. You will go through year after year of our architectural journals, and you will never find the word apartheid mentioned or any direct policy related to it, even though architecture was serving the apartheid project, So you have this, or what we're going to talk about this week and next week is, or what is architectural politics? Architecture has a politics, okay? There are things that we speak about and things that we don't speak about, and there are ways that we speak about the things that we speak about. Everything, there's a politics to everything that we do, and you guys as students are being educated. You are receiving a political education, okay? You are learning what you can and cannot speak about, how you should speak about things, what are taboo, what is acceptable to talk about, what is too troublesome to talk about, what, all this stuff is part of your education. It's like a hidden curriculum. It's part of the curriculum, but it's never stated explicitly, but you are all learning it. So what is really useful about this article is that it's written at this time and it reflects back on the last years of apartheid, which is fantastic. So in the last years of apartheid, right at the end of the 80s, there was a small group of architects in Johannesburg, that tried to get a resolution passed by the Transvaal Institute of Architects, and then it would there would be repercussions, and it would eventually they expected all architects in the country to take up their resolution. So this is the story by them. It's written by Ivan Clive Chipkin. Remember Chipkin we covered in the first semester, right? The architectural historian. He was part of this group as well. At this time he would have been a young man. Henry Payne. These are the people who write the article, and these guys were part of that little group in Johannesburg at the end of the 80s that formed this this little informal organization called Architects Against Apartheid, which they shortened to AAP, right, which is an ape in Afrikaans. So they were being sort of tongue-in-cheek about that. So they're reflecting on what was the climate in which they put together this resolution, and they're going to try to get it passed by the Architectural Institute, right? This little band of rebels, right? They form this organization, Architects Against Apartheid. And the article here describes the context in which it is formed, and it describes the response of the architectural body, right? Of the hundreds and hundreds of other architects in the Transvaal. What was their response to this? So let's go through that, and then we'll conclude with how this still matters to us today. Chipkin and Ivan and Payne are writing, right? So they begin with a quote here. Ideas talked about, yet unthinkable on one day, acquire life in the next, while others, which had seen solid fact, pass out of reality. So what they're saying is, at one time something seems normal, and other things seem unthinkable, but a little time can pass, and those things that were unthinkable are now spoken about, right? And he's referring to this, what he's writing now could not have been written just a few years before. So this is 1994, is obviously, you know, the culmination of all the deals and the transition politics that happened in the 1990s to transfer from the National Party to a democratically elected party, and various reforms happened. And now in 1994, it's the first time that it's really possible for something like this to be said, right? Because in the 80s, it was impossible to talk about architectural politics. For the first time, those things that were now unthinkable to speak about openly can now be spoken about. So this is what this article is about, right? So let's read on in the second paragraph. The events surrounding AAP belong to what seemed like a distant era when the government could summarize its policy in a striking sentence: we lay the table and those who won't sit down can do without, right? So the government is saying to all the professions, including architects, you follow our line, basically. And if you don't follow our line, you don't get work from us, right? And the government was the biggest client for architects. So architects wanted government work. They all sort of fell over themselves to try to get government work. So they were all completely enmeshed in the government's politics. The 1980s were a period of intermittent reforms, a period of endless waiting with spectacular hints followed by draconian measures and long periods of deep freeze. All around, deeply entrenched behavioral patterns seemed impervious to argument. The ad hoc reforms that did materialize were, as Business Day commented in 86, confined within a set of racist assumptions complemented by legislations, the Notorious Group Areas Act. It was such measures that prevented architecture from being an autonomous apolitical activity, as claimed by many in the architectural establishment or by the lackluster reformist in the profession. Now, this is a really important point he's making here. Yeah. That there is this idea that was present in the 70s, or present in the 80s, or was present in the 90s, was present in the noughties, in the 10s, and is still with us to this, right? It's this idea that architecture is an autonomous apolitical activity. What do they mean by that? It means that architecture has got nothing to do with politics. Keep politics out of architecture, right? It's separate, it's its own discipline, it's its own profession. We make beautiful buildings and spaces and we design lovely things and, you know, that's what we do, that's what we're trained to do. For God's sake, just leave politics out of architecture, and especially leave race out of architecture. Oh my God, you know, this is the argument today. And you know, we're seeing things, if you're following the media, you know, the cricket scandal, you know, it's the same argument, leave politics out of cricket, you know. So Chipkin and others are saying here, this is the argument, that architecture is so deeply entrenched in all the racial norms of the society and all the rules and regulations that come with that. But it imagines itself as apolitical and autonomous, as separate and independent, right? This is really important because this is still with us. This is our argument to this day, okay? This is the period when the United Democratic Front was mobilizing support on the 10th anniversary of the 76 tragedy in Soweto. Right, the Soweto uprising. Many professional groups were openly challenging government policies, especially the doctors and lawyers. As a profession of architects, though, were quiet as mice. Right, so other professions were taking explicit positions against the policies of the apartheid government, but not architects. Architects refused to do that. They were as quiet as mice, as Chipkin and these other guys said, not willing to take any position, even the most trivial, even the most light position, refused to take any position against apartheid policies. And this is right at the end of apartheid, right? This is just before the elections. Many were too busy nibbling away at the great apartheid cheese. In other words, the government is their main client, right? They were too busy nibbling away at the great apartheid cheese, preoccupied with all those structures of separate development, such as segregated homelands, learning institutions, vast complexes for the proliferating bureaucracies, police headquarters, etc. So these are all the projects of the government, where the writ of habeas corpus did not apply. That's a legal ruling anyway. Settlements from Peju and District 6 and places for tin pot dictators, right? In other words, they're not willing to take any position against apartheid because they are benefiting so much from apartheid. There's so much work, every kind of work is coming to architects, okay? So yeah, early in 1986 now, the architect Hans Schumacher went from office to office. So this is a Joburg architect. He went from office to office, contacting a handful of colleagues in order to do something about this situation. Are you guys still with me?
Yep.
You guys, okay. I'm talking a lot. Okay. Let's just check that you guys were still awake. I'm not putting you to sleep. No?
Yes.
Yes, I am putting you to sleep. I'm just checking that people are alive on the other side. It's a short article, so I tried to keep it as short as possible. Okay. So where were we? Early in 86, Hans Schumacher went from office to office. It's actually a very exciting story, okay? And I hope I'm conveying the sense of excitement. So Schumacher went from office to office, contacting a handful of colleagues in order to do something about the situation. Schumacher was the recipient of an award of merit from the establishment, was a hater of racism, as well as an impatient, mercurial, and flamboyant personality. Thus was Architects Against Apartheid born, metamorphosized into ARP. And then other people got involved, and we don't have to mention all of this, these names, right? Let's go on to the next paragraph. This informal pressure group challenged their colleagues to support radical changes to the Architects Act of 1970 and the Code of Conduct of the Institute of South African Architects. ARP members tried to make colleagues aware of how the gross application of apartheid ideology to architecture was distorting the moral and ethical basis of the profession in South Africa. Just seeing if other people are. Okay. So this is a really good point here. The application of apartheid ideology to architecture was distorting the moral and ethical basis of the profession in South Africa. So the ethics in our profession and the morality in our profession has been profoundly shaped by the social and political climate, right? So our morality in our profession and our ethics in our profession is determined by its context, okay? And that context has distorted our ethics. So what we consider ethical is not, it's not like universal, it's not like that's just the way it is. It is, it has been shaped and molded by the context in which it existed in, right? And this is also with us to this day. So what we're going to do in this course is we're going to go back and forward in time, 80s, 90s, 2000, 2020, and look at how things change and how things don't change, how this morality and ethical basis of our profession has been shaped, right? In addition, ARP was particularly disturbed by members of the Institute's hierarchy traveling overseas to put South Africa's case against the expulsion from international bodies and the REBA, the Royal Institute of British Architects. So a REBA was, look, but by this time, by late 80s, 1990, apartheid and explicit racist policies were a pariah in the world, right? It was no longer acceptable to have these kinds of public policies. So South Africa was incredibly marginalized and there was international sanctions against them, right? And so the Architectural Institute of Architects and its representatives were going around the world trying to normalize relations, trying not to be treated as a pariah, trying not to get sanctions against South Africa and against the architectural profession, right? So this little group was against that. But the Institute was arguing that the profession in South Africa did not discriminate on the basis of race and that our architecture schools were all open to all, despite the fact that barely a single African graduate emerged from these institutions, right? You guys must jump in if you have any questions, hey? So you have this, the architectural profession and its representative bodies in the institutes were really benefiting from all this apartheid work of the government, work that was coming to the profession. And they didn't want any kind of ostracization. In fact, they were going around the world petitioning that there mustn't be any sanctions and the profession mustn't be in South Africa, mustn't be targeted. And it's all above board and there's no discrimination whatsoever, despite the fact that the whole profession was entirely white, right? They argued that there was no discrimination. They were disturbed too, this little group, by the Institute extending an invitation to the administrator of the Transvaal, Mr. Kreyvagen, as an honored guest to present the architectural awards, right? Okay. So what we go on here to, so they call a meeting, right? In March 1986, they call a meeting all across the Transvaal. And they're going to try to get a resolution against the racist legislation of the state. They managed to get 158 signatures calling for a general assembly of the Transvaal Provincial Institute, okay? And because they managed to get this many assemblies, the Transvaal Institute, a provincial institute, had to call an official meeting. The general meeting was called to discuss the ARP resolution, which in essence would make it unethical for architects to design any buildings restricted for use on the grounds of race, design any building other than housing in the so-called homelands, which would promote separate development, design any buildings which would assist in enforcing apartheid policy, right? So this little group up, they basically want the architectural profession not to perpetuate apartheid, right? They're not asking for any protests or any kind of revolution. They're just saying, don't do that, right? Don't make buildings that are designed to segregate on the grounds of race. Don't do that. Don't create segregated developments in the homelands, etc. Right. And if you look at the original article, the whole resolution is in that original article. So this is not it's not incredibly radical. You know, it's not asking people to protest in the streets or to, you know, burn down anything or to leave the country. It's just saying, don't do racist things. You know, segregating your buildings, don't do that. Segregated developments, don't do that, right? Don't support that project. This is basically what the resolution is. If you read that original article, at the end of it, the whole resolution is in there, so you can read all their points. But in essence, that is what it is about. Any questions, guys? You still with me? Fatima?
Yes, so we are.
Let's read on. So now we're at this meeting, right? So they managed to get enough signatures that the Transvaal Provincial Institute of Architects had to call a meeting. So now we're in this, this meeting is going to happen now. So what's going to happen at this meeting? Here we're in 7th of July, 1996. We're in the Great Hall of Johannesburg, the College of Education, where this thing is taking place. The ARP resolution was a bombshell for the profession. Architects were busting from all over the Transvaal, from a far field as Potchefstroom, Pietersburg, Nelspruit. All the government planning agencies were represented. The hall was filled by a capacity crowd of approximately 700 members. Mr. Van der Westhuizen, president of the Provincial Institute and chairman of the meeting, was presiding over it. Now we're in the meeting, right? Presided over by the president of the Provincial Institute. To a barrage of interruptions and cries of politics. Okay, you must sort of put yourself in the in that space. So here you're in this big grand hall, 700 people packed in there to capacity, you know, architects from all over the Transvaal. And Schumacher and his colleagues are trying to present this resolution. And the people are all shouting them down, politics, politics. You can just imagine, right? Don't bring politics into architecture. This is the claim. But of course, architecture is thoroughly enmeshed in politics. It's inseparable from the political environment. But the claim here by this capacity crowd is politics, politics. Don't bring politics into architecture, right? So Schumacher was barely able to speak to the ARP resolution, and Clive Chipkin to the second motion. Immediately, Mr. Van der Westhuizen submitted a counter-resolution from the floor, which proposed in a single, memorably ungrammatical sentence that the ARP resolution be not put. Okay, this is obviously Afrikaans, right? That the resolution be not put. So they were barely able to present the resolution, and it was shouted down, and a counter-resolution was proposed that this resolution must not be adopted. This was carried by approximately 300 votes to 200, right? So the majority in the crowd immediately put together a counter-resolution and shot down this little rebel group trying to oppose apartheid. The meeting was brought to an abrupt halt. Right, it was over. The victors were jubilant. The remainder left the hall bewildered. Many of those who voted against the termination of the meeting were not supporters of the proposal, but acted in favor of fair play. Others from major practices were waiting in the wings to propose amendments that would have toned down the original proposals and emasculated ARP's intentions. Right, so the meeting was over, barely before it started. a counter resolution was put forward and it was adopted by the majority. And those who did support it were kind of just bemused by the whole thing. Schumacher, Stacey, Van Schalk resigned from the Institute in disgust. Others withheld payment of their membership dues or turned their backs on the Institute and its activities. The subsequent events are worth recording as we doubt whether they have ever been published before, right? So this is the first time in history that these kinds of things were ever published. These internal workings of the architectural profession in South Africa. 2 days after the meeting, the security police visited the TPI offices at Northwoods and removed a list of names of the supporters of the ARP resolution. So the apartheid security police comes in and gets the names of all those people that supported the resolution, right? So this is scary stuff that's happening now. At this stage, we are not ready to reveal how the names of the supporters were identified. So even in 1994, architects were scared to say how these things are unfolding. They don't want to reveal it just yet. Schumacher's home in 6th Avenue, Melville, was visited by the security police. And for a while, Hans went into hiding. Imagine an architect going into hiding before leaving for overseas. Other members suffered prolonged harassment through phone tapping, surveillance, night calls, death threats at 2 a.m. in the morning, and even a campaign of disinformation. Can you imagine how scary this situation must have been, guys? This little band of brave people trying to take what for us now seems like a very, you know, hardly very radical thing, you know? So you can imagine what the climate was like in the last days of apartheid. Both Schumacher and Van Schaik left the country. ARP regrouped to become a foundation member of the human rights organization, the Five Freedoms Forum. ARP members realized that paying any further, they decided to channel their energies to an alternative purpose. The members started an architectural drafting school in the Alexandra Art Center in Alexandra Township, which has continued to give classes to the present day, in other words, 1994, under the current chairman, Shipkin and Payne, right? So instead of explicitly being involved in politics, which was a dead end for them and their lives were threatened as a result, they started going into black townships like Alexandra and trying to teach people drafting. And, you know, that's where they started channeling their energies because they couldn't get any luck from any of the official actual bodies and representatives. In retrospect, and from the vantage point of 1994, and this is our last paragraph here now, the ARP resolution seems quite mild, and it is mild, and the hullabaloo it caused quite unnecessary. Events have overtaken us, and the revolution happened anyway without the assistance of architects. This is also a very good point. The revolution happened anyway without the assistance of architects. So architects were opposed to changing the norms. And then when they changed anyway, then architects just sort of jumped on the last carriage in the direction things were going anyway. But they had no part to play in actually changing anything. In fact, they actively resisted it. It would be interesting to know, though, how many of the indigent, now Chipkin and the other guys are now commenting on their colleagues, their architectural colleagues, and how they are now going to adjust to this new political situation, right? It would be interesting to know, though, how many of the indignant fat cats who threw the ARP resolution, or the liberal case putters who were spared the discomfort of voting against it on that cold winter afternoon in 1986, have crossed the threshold of the ANC offices to present their plans for the structures of the new South Africa. Right? This is a damning indictment that they are giving of our profession. They are saying, and they are absolutely correct, that all those architects and professions just before the demise of apartheid were completely opposed to changing the racist policies. And just after the transition, these very same architects and officers are now doing projects for the new South Africa, right? If nothing else, they say, it would show us how adaptable we are as a profession.